What is up, guys? You're here to figure out how to get some big round delts, not some strange looking half deflated basketball delts. That's what I visualize with a bad. If we do this right, if my man Brady does this right, we're gonna have a cool cover that shows a big round basketball as the goal or a half deflated basketball. And that's what we don't want. And we'll do something where there's a happy person with a round basketball or a flat basketball. We'll see if we can do it. I have this vision in my mind. It's gonna be horrible. You guys have already seen it if it worked out. Or right now you're gonna be like, damn it, Brady, why is it so bad? But anyway, so you are here. I got sidetracked to figure out how to get big old round delts. So that's what we're gonna show you, my preferred workout for most people. And then we'll obviously talk through some stuff, show you some stuff. And again, get some big, giant, round, awesome delts. And that's the good thing about delts. If you're watching this right now, I'm gonna take my magic genie hypertrophy ball and I'm gonna tell you, big, giant, round delts will make your physique look better. I don't care if you wanna be a 300-pound bodybuilder or you wanna be a 120-pound bikini competitor or you just wanna look good on the beach or you wanna take your shirt off in front of your wife or girlfriend and have them stop laughing at you, big, giant delts will help because it only makes more of a V-taper. So this workout is specifically for you. Enjoy. This is my hack I invented and everyone stole.
Yeah, I'm gonna steal that.
Yeah. I can't prove that I'm the first person to do it, but I'm just gonna say I did because it's the internet. So for anybody that didn't catch why I did that at home, now she can bring them to here. Whereas if the cable was hooked all the way here, she'd have to stop basically here before these things like clank together. I've literally had people where they actually clip the two carabiners together while they're going, which is highly entertaining. So this way, again, you get more range of motion before this crap bangs into each other and just becomes a pain in the butt. So bring it here, and I want you going a little bit more out and down. So think wide first, this way, this way, this way, and finishing more kind of in that position. Yeah, it'll feel like, honestly, the plane you kind of want to go in is going to be more from kind of a little bit of a high to low type thing, and we'll tweak this as we go. So actually stop for a second. No, actually a little bit more. There you go. Try that. See how that feels.
Keep my elbows fixed?
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing wrong with a slight bend. I just don't want them to bend, because the more you bend, the more it's kind of a rotation exercise. And then I want you to mess around. We'll keep coming back, keep coming back, keep going, keep going, keep going, unless it hurts.
No, okay, just good. My chest is super tight.
Yep. There you go. They'll help open up your chest. Okay. If you want a funny goal that'll feel good, is how close can you get that cable to your shoulder? Yeah.
Ooh.
And if that feels good, go there. Generally, the lower you go, the more internally rotated you'll be at your GH joint, your shoulder joint, and the higher you go, the more externally rotated you'll be. So really, so for everybody watching at home as well too, that's the big difference as far as height, lower or higher. Go which feels most comfortable to you, because with either setup, whether low or again higher, you can actually line up the cable in direct opposition of your side delt with either. So neither one's better for side delts, but one position can feel better for some people than others. But if you do this cool little Joe hack, which I'm gonna call it, see, have it so the ball and crap, whatever you want to call it, is pointing this way. So go ahead and pull them back, because if you pull all the way back to the top, eventually, see how this doesn't run into her, and see how that does run into her? So that's annoying, but might as well not have that, right? So that's why we flip it around. Thing pointing out. Got it? And all joking aside, it's probably one of the best things you could do to stretch your chest. Because like, so the funny thing is, like, if anytime you want to stretch something and something's tight, lots of times your body just kind of freaks out a little bit. There's nothing that really neurologically says, hey, let's go to this position. But if you actively contract yourself there, then there's something basically where if you can actively go there, your body's going to say, okay, we can go here and it's safe and it's comfy. So most of the time, I would almost guarantee once we're done with all these sets, your chest won't feel as tight. So again, good cues on this. So again, there's no right or wrong with cues. When I say good cues, I mean stuff that seems to help when I give them to people, is it's an arc. So anytime you're doing an arcing motion, where you're pressing and the direction you're pressing is gonna change depending on how much range of motion you go through here. So really we're kind of going through, if we're looking at the joint, a little over 90 degrees range of motion. So that's how much the direction, if we think right now we're starting, we're pushing this way, and by the time you finish, you're really pushing that way. So I like to think when you're starting the motion is think about out or wide. Almost anytime you're doing a lateral raise, that's a great cue, is thinking this way. So because again, when people wanna cheat, they'll immediately kind of bend stuff and pull stuff like this, you know? And so that changes things mechanically about where the contact point is relative to the joint. but it also can just be a way of involving more stuff. So if you think wide, it's going to get a lot of recruitment from where we want in that length and position of that delt. And then as you think wide, at some point in time, technically in the middle, we start going more instead of out, more down. And then that's when that cue is, sometimes I'll talk about hands to the floor, or like I gave them two cables to the shoulder. The reason I like that cue a lot as well too, is it helps people forget about hands. So again, it just helps them focus on this pulling down. So anything that helps you focus a little bit more down, especially if you're doing this variation and finishing this far, can be good cues to have. So any lateral raise variation, think wide to start. And then again, as you're doing that one, you can actually think down kind of more to the finish. One more.
Go.
Nice. Pull that plate, Fifth. Right there. Go. A little straighter. There we go. Pause. Hard contraction. There we go. Keep it moving. Nice control. Pause. Hard contraction. Good. Good. Fight the eccentric. Fight it. Go. Come on. Fight it. Go. Nice. Come on. Again. Keep fighting. Go. Nice. We got five. Best ones. Fight it. Good. Four. Come on. Keep fighting. Good. Come on. Let's go three now. Come on, push. Good. Two more, come on. Fight it. Push. Come on, go. Good. One more, come on. Push. Go. Finish. Nice. Okay. Arms up. If you can, right there. And resist. Good. Nice. Keep fighting. Come on. Keep fighting. Come on, you got this. Come on, keep fighting. Come on, don't let me beat you. Let's go. Come on. There we go. Come on. Keep fighting. Keep resisting. Come on. Keep going. Come on, keep going. Feel like you're pushing me back up. Let's go, come on. Keep going. Keep pushing straight out now. Pushing out. To the walls. Keep going, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Nice. Raise your hand if you're having fun.
Wow. That's a better workout than
the whole workout. The whole workout. Wow.
So again, as far as height is concerned, you know, some people will kind of be confused about how can high and how can low kind of line up the same way with the side delt. So if you're going low, you know, so I'd even want the cable lower from here. So imagine the cable is going from that direction straight across. Then I want to make sure that the delt, side delt, is lined up in direct opposition. So here, how her arm is right now, she's a little bit more internally rotated. And hopefully, if you can imagine, again, a plane that's flat, you know, flat relative to the ground, this plane, that's the main plane that her side delt would be moving in. Now, if we go up here, where we've got it a little bit higher and she's coming in this position, if we kind of pulled straight back, the delt would be sitting a little bit more like kind of forward. So it would actually be a little bit more kind of rear delt and side delt. So we actually want her externally rotating a little bit. So that's where we had this position a little bit more as we were going. And that, you can see, changes the whole position. So if we turn and turn, you can see how our actual delt, because it attaches to her humerus, will actually move. The muscle belly will move a little bit. So you have to be a little bit more externally rotated when you're higher. And that's gonna have, again, if you imagine this plane we're moving in now is no longer flat to the ground, it's more kind of at this angle. And if we look at where her side delt is, that's basically the plane that we have it lined up. So as she pulls back through here, a lot of people will see this and just see the kind of upper arm going forward to back, and they always automatically think rear delt. And again, if we were in this more internally rotated position, it probably would be a little bit more rear delt. But because we're more externally rotated, the rear delt goes more this way, a little bit more out of plane, and this keeps the side delt a little bit more in plane. And so again, it's not a better or worse type thing, but some people that will feel a lot different at their actual shoulder joint. You hear people talking about, rightly so, a lot of avoiding too much internal or too much external rotation. There's no position that's arbitrarily good or bad for everyone, but there will be people that really internally rotated does feel bad, which means it's a bad position for you, or really externally rotated can even feel bad. So again, this gives you some options to kind of find the lateral raise variation that works well for you. And the only other difference is if you're doing flat, more internally rotated, generally it's going to be more just due to length and mid-range, where you find for most people it's not too comfortable to try and really shorten your delt as far as it goes up here. Whereas again, if you do more externally rotated and get in a little bit of a different plane, most people can comfortably really shorten their front delt here as well too. And again, I wouldn't say that's a must, but this is a pretty good exercise to do it, because where this cable is relative to the joint, there's a lot less joint torque and a lot here. So it really overloads muscles where I think is the best place to grow mid and length and ranges. And again, even if you go to this shortened position to get some stimulus there, it's a lot less load. So either one's fine, even though this one will have a little bit more range of motion than this variation. I think they're both gonna train the muscles the most. You can take your arm out. Ah, she can't move. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of an idea of one, how to mess around and how things kind of change with the setup, but both can be really, really good options. They just bring something a little bit different to the table. So we're gonna do this for rear delts. For you guys doing, like, I like doing reverse pec deck a lot. I always like something that can load, obviously, through this range of motion. But obviously cables have the advantage of having a little bit more same options, so we can kind of mess around with this type of stuff and not be so fixed in one plane, mess around with this type of stuff a little bit. So for setup, we're gonna go basically as close as you can without like your kind of like your hand getting too much into the cable, if that makes sense. So if I was scooted really close, then they kind of start to run into each other at the end. Or if I'm back just a little bit, they kind of start where they're really not in the way. You can bring your hands pretty much all the way together, get some good load there. It'll technically be like heaviest right around here, and then pull all the way back. So I don't really care. Because of the load's not really that heavy and it's pulling mostly this way and that way. Like, I like the bench just as reference, so you can just stay still, but you don't have to be on it if you don't want to. So really, if you want to just sit here, just keep your lower body nice and still. You know, you can see the bench to make sure you're not doing like this kind of thing to finish, or if you're more comfortable on it, that's fine as well too. And then we'll just mess around a little bit with height, position, see what feels good. Same thing, I really just like the cue of think wide to start. So really think that first motion, push wide, and then just kind of finish focusing on squeezing the delt. I also like that too, and don't worry too much about what your scapula do, right? I mean, you wouldn't want to do like, don't think shrug, don't think hard retraction to finish, but just kind of let them go where they go. Drive wide, squeeze, good reps. Keep it right there. Feel that stretch, stretch, stretch. Wide, 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 wide. Stretch. Wide, 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 wide. Squeeze, squeeze, really good. Good, I'm gonna need you a little bit to finish those reps. You stay right on it. Drive wide, go, 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 go. Good, let's go one more. Control, just keep that focus right there. Drive to the wall as hard. Go, 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 go. Nice. Really good. All right, guys, so hopefully this makes sense for people. I wanted to draw something on here to give everyone a little bit of visual. What am I looking at when I'm training someone's rear delts? Now, again, this is kind of nuanced, right? So again, if I can make some adjustments while I'm setting up to put her in the best position, I think, to work rear delts, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm not saying subtle variations of this position won't also work rear delts. The goal is, this is my job, I'm gonna try and do the best that I can for someone that it makes a difference for. Like, if you're a Mr. or Mrs. Jones and you want something back here working, just pull back. You're a long way off from this mattering. But when I'm looking at her, and I was looking at her, said, well, first we'll go two things. At some point in time, some really smart dum-dum said, looking at the upper arm and the rear delt sitting in this position, and they said, this is just how the rear delt tissue lies. So because this is how it lies, this is the only motion that you can really train in, for a bunch of made up reasons that sound smart but are actually really dumb. The reason it's really dumb is the origin insertion have two different spots. And depending on where, especially in this case, you move the insertion, it completely changes the fiber orientation. So again, people that are really, really smart, some normal person probably was like listening to this really smart person say this at some point in time, I think that doesn't sound right, but they didn't want to say anything to sound stupid. Well, no, it really doesn't sound right because it's not right. So the orientation of the rear delts depends on where you put your upper arm. It's not something that just stays in place. So all that means is this a great position to train rear delts? Someone that likes to go more maybe this kind of 45 degree angle? Sure, it can be an awesome position to train rear delts. Can this be an awesome position to train rear delts? Yes, some people have kind of vilified or made terror around this kind of high elbow position, but if you do this and it's comfortable for your shoulder joint, a perfectly fine position. If it hurts when you're doing this, then, you know, then it's not a good position for you. And same thing as I go up here and I go more from this kind of high to low motion where we were at, you'll see that where I put the upper arm, the rear delt fiber orientation moves. So again, where I've kind of done the lines here is the insertion right here is a dot, where basically this is the shared insertion of all the heads of the rear delt. And I've kind of gone just by visual, what we would call the rear delt, you know, looking again from a pure visual standpoint, this is probably the top aspect of it, this is the bottom aspect, so we kind of go the middle. And I'm looking at this as the plane of motion we're trying to operate in and kind of set up best. So when she was setting up a little bit, again, we can adjust this with internal, external rotation, all that good stuff. This looked like a really good plane. So when I had grabbed up here, I like a little bit of a high to low position for a lot of reasons. I think it can help keep upper traps out of it a little bit, you know, it helps prevent this kind of shruggy type thing. It also tends to be a pretty comfortable position for people's shoulder joints. You can get a good stretch here in the lengthened position under load. Most people can actually bring it back pretty far if they want to really shorten the delt, though I don't think that's necessarily necessary. And if I'm looking at the plane of the cable, the plane of the upper arm, and the plane of the rear delt, you should see how all those things line up pretty well. So this is just to give you a little bit of a visual of what I'm looking at when I'm setting this stuff up. I showed Tiffany in a minute, so I put her at a slightly different position. And again, where people's delts sit is slightly different relative to her joint. So when I was setting Tiffany up, if this is where Mel's rear delt kind of sits, Tiffany sits a little bit lower, kind of like this. And so again, all that stuff is just very individual dependent. People's technical side delts aren't always perfectly on the side. Sometimes they sit more forward, more back. So when I was looking at Tiffany, hers sat a little bit lower like this, so that's why I set her cables up, if you didn't catch that, just probably that much higher. Now again, that's very, very individual dependent. Does that make a big difference for most people? Probably not, but again, I'm trying to put them in the best position to get the most out of the rear delts, so that was the reasoning for that setup. And I just wanted to draw on her too, so. Good rip. Really good. Right there, let's go one more. Go, 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 go. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Nice. Now just partials. Stretch them together. Right to focus there, straight out. Good, right there. Straight out, pause in the middle, then go, good. Nice, pause in the middle, go. Good, just a couple more right from there. Keep it right there, it's the only thing working. Good, three more. If it moves, it counts, just squeeze it. Good, keep it short, two more. Don't force the range, just squeeze. One more, drive out, squeeze. Good job, nice. All right guys, so I wanted to do a little bit set up here. Obviously, you saw me talk about this on Mel, and I wanna kind of talk through finding this. And again, obviously, don't go nerd on me, where I'm not saying this is a bad thing to do. This is my job, I'm a trainer, and I've got some kind of high level competitors here that can kind of illustrate a good point for you. But again, someone's gonna go in and start drawing on themselves, and they won't do rear delts without drawing on themselves, and then people will make fun of the nerds and blame me for it. I didn't do it. You nerds did it, so don't nerd on me. If you're trying to find these positions, it's a combination of one, having a delt and being pretty lean. And the cool part is when she raised up, I kind of drew on her a little bit, so we lost the natural lines a little bit. But you can see kind of where the front delt comes to a point, kind of that rear delt line comes to a point, and you should see kind of this shape right now, where again, to kind of get that little bit of almost like a triangle, diamond, whatever, obviously will go triangle since we're talking deltoids, and kind of come to a point. And again, that's gonna be that shared insertion. And then delts have like a broad origin. So they have a bunch of different spots where the front delt, the side delt, or the rear delt all attach. And again, when we're looking to find kind of this ballpark of where the rear delt is, we just wanna visually assess, okay, I'm gonna call this more side delt, I'm gonna call this more rear delt. And we're trying to basically get the origin right in between what we would consider kind of the top, I'd say right here. So hopefully you can see her side delt fairly pumped here, a pretty visual little separation between her side and her rear delt. And we can kind of see the bottom of the rear delt here. So again, we're kind of ballparking the middle of the origin. And then again, just connecting those points. And you should see, obviously, tissue is not always, you know, it's two points. It's not gonna be a straight line. It's gonna actually, that's why delts actually look kind of round, because it's kind of the culmination of tissue on tissue on tissue on tissue, you know, from more deep to more superficial. Whereas if someone was like completely emaciated, it's literally gonna be more of a straight line. So again, depending on the position we move it in, this is actually, I'm trying to do a pretty accurate drawing of when she's actually going as well too. You can visually kind of see, you know, where the center of that muscle belly is. And again, this is where it comes from people get, again, too smart and in turn get too dumb for their own good. Reading and concerned about studies and trying to figure out internal moment arms for which head work best in which plane. Most people just need a basic understanding of physics, where again, if I'm pulling something in this plane, whatever's back here on this side of the joint can do it the most. I mean, I could literally teach that to an 8-year-old, where this stuff is literally on the front of the joint. So even though they share a similar insertion, and if somebody measures the internal moment arms wrong, because the planes are all slightly different, which is really tricky, I don't even know how you would really properly do it, you know, you could actually mess up what the internal moment arms are for a given motion, because this is in direct opposition of this. So this muscle is literally incapable of pulling stuff this way. And again, if we know that this is the axis, that should make sense for someone. And pretty much anything on the back side of it can contribute in some capacity. So side delts are definitely working a little bit, but we're trying to put the most stuff right in opposition to that. And so that's how we decide what line's the best. And hopefully when you look between the two, we have some shots from the back. Tiffany being maybe 4 or 5 inches higher, you can hopefully see how that lines up pretty well for her, and her position still lines up pretty well for Mel. And again, that's subtle stuff if we're just gonna split hairs or split delts. That's what we're trying to do. Dad joke. I kind of want to set it to the point where once you get going, you can just kind of lightly touch. So the point where you almost bring it to your chest if it's comfortable, and then pressing straight up, pretty much just short of lockout. So you don't need to completely lock out. Somewhere right around there, if that makes sense. Got it? Yes. And I always say if it doesn't feel comfortable from a wrist standpoint, you can always go false grip or suicide grip. We've got a rack, because if you drop it, you just put it on the rack. You can actually just lightly touch. Yep, good. Press, perfect. And see how it feels, just slide your hips forward just a little bit. And if it feels more comfortable the other way, you can go right back. Just kind of want to see how that feels. Sometimes it actually lets the shoulder move a little bit more comfortably. And just go somewhere 6 to 8, just get until you feel like you're actually pretty comfortable with movement, kind of getting a little bit of a groove. The same exact thing, we'll start to get, you know, just feeling that weight. This will be something that if it feels comfy, I'll probably spot you on your working sets similar. Like if I get to the point of spotting, I'll just spot you from here and just take them to the point where maybe a little past failure, but I want to keep it like form failure here. So if anything ever feels like wobbly or whatever, we'll still get a lot of benefit taking it, you know, even if it's a short of failure. Which again, I think you'll be fine with pull points. These first few warm-ups, let's just really get in a nice groove where it feels comfy. Yeah, that's still good. You can touch the rack, perfect. Yep. Yeah, everyone just like that. Exciting thing.
That's pretty awesome.
I keep telling them, I have no affiliation with this company. I paid for this, but ProLock, bravo. Because in case anybody didn't catch that, magnets.
Oh, yeah.
It's probably the most exciting thing as far as equipment development's gone in the past 50 years, which should also tell you how shitty equipment development is right now. But that's, I'm not joking. True story. Good job, ProLock. Brilliant. Take your time. And again, pull it. Obviously, I don't want you catching your chin, but if you're too far out in front of you, you're going to deal with a lot of internal rotation.
Yeah.
So you want to get to the point where it's pretty close to your chest. And then before you press, make sure your elbow is right under your hand. So if you're back here, you're going to get in a weird spot to start. Or if you keep that elbow right under the hand, it's going to feel a little bit more smooth. And that first one, always just press slow, literally, so you don't catch yourself in the chin. Because if I've not that I've ever done that. That's what I grew out my beard for, was to protect from hitting myself in the chin. Perfect reps now. Nice. Again. Nice. We got two now. You keep them locked in. I'll get you there. Control that bar path. You got it. Pause. Hard press. Yeah. One more. Nice set.
Thank you.
All right, guys, so just talking through why this you know, I hate to use the word best or favorite or whatever, but a great place to start for a, you know, overhead press variation. So again, I do a bunch of different overhead press. I don't think there's one definitively way better than the others. I have lots of people who are at this point in a session, I might do a machine for the fact that, you know, you're a little fatigued and obviously there's more to stabilize with this. But I kind of gauged on the warm-up. They still looked good, enough control where we could really still get a lot out of it. And it's not more of an expenditure on balance than it is on effort from front delts. The other thing I love about this variation is standardizing the reps. So one, I like setting up to where you're basically doing a rack press, determine what your true bottom range of motion is, which again, for most people will be to the bar, kind of somewhere upper chest. Again, you're really just looking at where your upper arm can go because your delt attaches to your upper arm, not your hand, not your lower arm. But for most people, it's gonna end up again, lower than where most people bring it. So I like to standardize the range of motion with the rack, and then it's also super safe. Because if for some reason you're by yourself, you wanna take sets far, I mean, if you really got in a bad spot, you could just drop it forward and be safe. Or obviously, if you can't start a rep, you just set it down on the rack and you're good to go. The other reason I like this variation too, is you'll see I'm getting them in a more tucked position as opposed to out here. Now there's nothing wrong with out here, but if you can imagine her holding a bar, I just wanted you guys to be able to see it. If she brings it down, like that's essentially where your bottom range of motion is. And as you bring it up, that's essentially where the top is, because obviously the bar is gonna limit how high she can, or how close she can adduct her upper arm here. And on the way down, kind of the same thing is gonna happen. And so if you actually looked at how many degrees that is, I mean, I could actually do that at some point in time with a graphic, but I'm not that fancy. But let's say that's going through 90 degrees range of motion. If we go in a more tucked position, everyone's able to drop it down further and bring it up higher. So just by keeping the hands a little bit closer together, you're generally gonna pick up anywhere from, I'm gonna make these numbers up, but eyeballing at 30, 40 degrees range of motion. So one, you get more range of motion. Most importantly, you get this stretched range of motion. So again, if you're getting an extra, you know, 20 degrees range of motion, arguably where front delts, like every muscle can grow the best, I think is lengthened through mid-range. So both of those ranges of motion. This tucked position is gonna allow you to get there a whole lot, actually allow you to get to that length as opposed to being stuck out here. And then the last thing too is, this tends to be a very comfortable plane of motion for people to go from a joint standpoint. So this isn't a hard, fast rule, but as you further and further abduct the upper arm, which is this direction, we're gonna talk that type of abduction, the more you kind of get where stuff goes against stuff. So the head of the humerus can kind of go against the top of that acromion, and sometimes you smush some of that stuff in that subacromial space. So again, it's not that back here is bad, but the further back you go, the further back you go, the more people are gonna have kind of discomfort, pain, tightness as they try and press straight up and down. And so that's where stuff where people talk about behind the neck press is a bad exercise. For someone, it's fine. But for most people, it's not gonna be very comfortable, and they'll just be more comfortable getting a little bit more here and a little bit more tucked in. So favorite variation, I think the main reason people don't do this variation more is because if you stop here, it's a lot easier than if you go down here. So that's probably the main reason people avoid this. If you bring it all the way down, I see a lot of people that pick arbitrary things on their face. I don't really know how that works, where it's like some people, if your beard's longer, it's the bottom of your beard. Some people, then it's your chin if you don't have a beard. Some people, for whatever reason, it's their nose, right above their nose or at their eyes. I'd rather look at the upper arm because, again, your delt doesn't attach to your beard, chin, or nose. That's all arbitrary stuff. I want my upper arm as tucked in at the side as it can go because that will provide the most length and the most challenge of the front delt in that position. But again, when you get down in this position, it's a lot of range of motion and it's really hard. But if you want big delts, I would argue that's a little bit more efficient. This is fine too. It's really just gonna overload the mid-range. But again, if we're playing that kind of game of pick one exercise or which one's best or which one's arguably more efficient, if you're only gonna program one overhead press, I like this variation as a great option to go with. So basically just face pull variation. So, you know, kind of for the most part, this is gonna be the most comfortable. There's nothing really wrong with the other position, but I'm gonna have you start with overhand as long as it feels comfortable. And I'm gonna have this set so it doesn't bottom out for you, which it probably won't with your arm length. But basically just go straight from here and don't overthink it. You're just trying to bring the top of your hand facing behind you. So again, it doesn't make a huge difference for all intents and purposes if it's here or if it's up a little bit, you know, so just somewhere around here. Just focus on pulling it this way and we'll get what we're after. Got it? Obviously then just smooth on the first one, depending on how much range of motion you have. You can technically whack yourself in the face, but more than likely it's gonna be slightly painful to get back there on your delt, but just a fair warning. Squeeze, go, 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 go. Fight it out. Keep going. Squeeze, good, keep them smooth. Come on, left shoulder, cooperate. Two more, I got you. Go. One more, come on. Go. Nice. Nice work. Good set. Dunzo.
Wow.
The Delft pump. Yep. Keep going. Good, come on. Hard squeeze. On that end. Squeeze. Yep. Good, keep going. Go, 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 go. Come on. Come on, you got more in there. Let's go. Hard squeeze, hard squeeze. Go, 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 go. Come on. Again. Come on. Go, 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 go. Come on, get him all the way back. Drive that hand back. Hard squeeze. Good, we got one more. Go, 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 go. Come on, come on, come on. Slow back. Nice job. Good set. You don't do side chest a whole lot in the wellness? You'll be the first one up there hitting the side chest. All right, guys, so just a brief talk through why I'm finishing with this face pull variation. I honestly like it for a little bit of everything, right? So if you've paid attention, we've trained or tried to bias exercises that are gonna be mainly for side, mainly for rear, mainly for front. And again, it's kind of a personal preference, coaching preference that I like to finish with this exercise. Again, that means nothing that I'm saying this is definitively the best or magical, but here's my reasons for it. So I like face pull variations, again, more towards the end when we can do it kind of in a safe, controlled environment, because it really involves every head of the delt. And it also involves a little bit of kind of training that external rotation motion, which again, some people will kind of praise as this magical corrective thing, which is a load of crap, but it's certainly not a bad thing either. So the couple of reasons, one, I'm gonna have Tiff do, just do a face pull standing up or sitting up, just like that, yeah. So the main reason I do this variation, go ahead and go like you're gonna go. You got anything left in there?
Yeah.
So I like this, a lot of people when they do this variation, there's two things I don't love about this. The way this cable is set up at this point in time is it makes this position the heaviest, and that's where basically you're gonna be the weakest at this point in time. And the other thing I don't like about it is a lot of people when they do face pulls, they move everything. So they're so concerned about getting this to a certain point, they start to move their whole upper body and everything. So by laying back, go ahead and lay all the way back for me now. By laying back in this exact same position here, so this line of force, which is the cable here, has now pulled closer to the shoulder joint. So if we're measuring where that line of force is, and again, that perpendicular distance, again, hopefully you guys can all remember where she was before, it's probably gonna be 12 inches away from her shoulder joint here at 6 inches away. And so when she brings it out here, somewhere right around here is actually the heaviest point. So basically we're loading the muscles a little bit heavier where they're stronger, and we're having it drop off and get a little bit lighter where it's shorter muscle length as well too. And then also she's lying back, so less likely to cheat. So that's the main reason, I'll have you put this up, but you can stay there. That's the main reason I like this variation. Again, subtle stuff, not saying the other one's bad or whatever, but again, I just would make the argument this is a little bit more efficient, and again, a little bit stricter, which again, I can't think of a reason why you would wanna not be strict if the goal is to develop a muscle group. The other thing I like about there where I say it's a little bit of everything is before the elbow bends, as the motion just starts, it's predominantly rear delt. And as soon as this forearm gets out of the same plane as the cable and starts to go like this, it really does two things. So as this externally rotates, we're starting to put more heads of the delt kind of behind the joint. We're starting to pull this direction. So as she kind of goes like this, we're starting to kind of hand off as far as moving this or this direction, not just rear delt, but also getting the side delt. And as you come into the very finished part, even the front delt can contribute a little bit. So here at this point is the axis that we're actually moving through. So again, pulling the arm this way. Everything this side of that axis can work. So we're getting, again, a little bit of rear delt, side delt, and front delt, and it kind of moves in that direction where it's more rear delt and then just starts to contribute more and more of every head of the delt as you go to finish. And then also, as soon as that elbow bends and we start to have this rotation component, again, nothing's lined up anymore, this force is also not just her arm pulling it back this way, but also she has to externally rotate essentially this direction. So it's two motions kind of happening at the same time. And again, if she's externally rotating, fighting this, it's her external rotators, if it makes sense, that have to pull in that direction as well too. So again, we're getting a little extra stimulus there. So the reason I like to finish with that is, again, it gets a little bit of everything that's left from what we just trained. And also we're getting something a little bit different there as far as, you know, actual some external rotation training as well too. So whenever I'm doing exercises, I don't want a whole lot of redundancy in the workout. And that way, just those four motions, again, there's no real big overlap or anything that I would consider redundant. All right, so talking through that a little bit, I think the number one thing that I'm gonna hear coming out of that workout, as soon as we're showing the beginning and someone's saying, why are we starting with a raise? you have to start with an overhead press because that's the best mass builder. Now again, believe me, none of that concept is lost on me. You know, if you had to say you can only pick one shoulder exercise, what's gonna literally put on the most pounds? Obviously an overhead press would put on more pounds than someone if we were comparing to any raise head to head, probably because it's just putting more tissue everywhere. You could argue the front delt has more overall growth potential, but if you're doing an overhead press, it just uses more muscles than, you know, like a lateral raise or something. But this is bodybuilding categories, physique categories, where you're training for your physique to look a certain way. So it's not just how much mass or volume can we put on at various places. There really is this goal or idea of aesthetic, what looks the best. And that comes into balancing different parts of body parts as well as everything else, in case you guys are new to the sport in general. So in my professional opinion, so your opinion you're gonna leave me in the comments and tell me how I'm wrong is amateur, so shut up. Just kidding, I love you all. But my professional opinion is that the vast majority of people that don't have that round delt, so people, when you talk about, people want cannonball delts or round delts, they want delts the size of basketballs. They're referencing round things. And when I look at people that have crap delts, very often from like looking at the side, they actually have a pretty substantial front delt, maybe sometimes some side delt, and then just like this flat, sad thing on the back of their arm there too. So it looks like, if Brady's gonna get it right, a deflated basketball, like again, the deflated side here and kind of some round side here, and obviously that doesn't look round. Where someone has a big round delt, that looks a lot like, again, everything's well-developed rear, side, and front. So for most people, especially people competing in some physique category, side delts being proportionately bigger than everything else, I think go a long way. There's sometimes I'll even switch the order. If someone's rear delts are really garbage enough, I'll do rear delts first. So again, it really goes with the idea of prioritizing whatever you train first in a workout will marginally get more stimulus than other body parts. So there's a reason that I started with, okay, side delts, then move to rear delts, and then finish with overhead press. Again, because any type of pressing is always gonna involve your front delts to a pretty large degree. And then again, it really, at this point in time, neither of them are like, I need to put on like 40 pounds, right? So again, if I had somebody that was brand new, how can I put on as much weight as possible? Maybe they're doing a full body workout or something. They're only gonna have one shoulder workout. Yeah, I can make a good argument where for newbie, overhead press and some sort of row is gonna get enough overall delt stimulus. But as you shift to being kind of more, I wanna look a certain way, I wanna prioritize and have this idea of proportion and balance, that's the reason why I start with side delts, then we went to rear delts, and then finished with overhead press. Anecdotally, having trained a lot of people this way, you don't actually lose that much strength in overhead pressing. So I've trained some ginormous guys, for people that are concerned about me training ginormous guys and not just ginormous females. And I've had people that can, before they start, normally if they started with overhead press, do three plates aside and still do three plates aside when they finish. So it really doesn't take away that much strength. And again, proportionately, I think has a more or a bigger impact on the physique, you know, than if you went in the other order. But if it really hurts your feelings, here's all you have to do. Do this workout, but change the order into whatever makes you happy or matches your physique. And again, in reality, there's someone out there that has huge rear delts and side delts, so you could just change the order. Or if you are the person with a really sad deflated rear delt, just do the rear delt movement first, then side delt, then front delt, whatever. So again, the sequence was tailored to their physiques and their goals, but I also think that order will work well for most people just based on when I walk around and judge people for their physique. Not in a bad way. It's my job, right? I don't judge people that don't ask me. And then I think the rest is overall relatively self-explanatory. So again, you know, people always see like, well, why sometimes people get really caught up on what I'm using, a cable, you know, a barbell, whatever it is. I don't really think of it that way. I think of what something has to offer. You know, so if you don't have the cables to set up for the lying raise variation, I think a lateral raise machine would be your next best bet for the same reason that it loads that bottom position. I think it's one of the few times where a machine or a cable's definitively, I hate to say, someone's gonna be upset and tell me about how much Ronnie Coleman lateral raise, but it's definitively better than a dumbbell lateral raise. That being said, as Ronnie Coleman has shown us, you can still get ginormous doing just dumbbell lateral raises. Although he did a machine raise too, now that I think about it. He had that badass Nautilus piece in Metroflex. So if you don't know what I'm talking about, shut up and stop using Ronnie as an example anyway. But so yes, you can still get huge if you don't have cables, you don't have machines. Dumbbell lateral raises are great. But same thing when I went to the cable, you know, you can do reverse pec deck, you could even do bent over dumbbells for your rear delt variation. But again, I just prefer cables because they load that lengthened and mid-range. And again, they just provide a ton of versatility. Lots of times when people bend over with a dumbbell or they even get in a pec deck, you get locked in a plane. And as you saw, hopefully, cables allow you to be more specific with really trying to target what we want to target. But so anyway, I just hopefully that points out where, yeah, sometimes I might choose to use two cables to start and then finish with a barbell or something. Again, depending on the individual, I don't really view exercises necessarily as good or bad, But if I have a lot of options, I'm gonna think with what are the things that are more efficient and tend to go with those. So that was the workout. So as always, they train really, really well. If you're watching at home, train like they do, because that's a good goal of very, very good form, especially when it matters when getting close to or past failure. Someone will ask the specifics. We probably did 4 working sets on the lateral raise, probably 3 working sets on the rear delt, I think 3 working sets on the overhead press, and then maybe I think 2 working sets, I think on the face pull, maybe 3, whatever. In general, and again, people don't like talking about this, especially the nerds, I think still that delts respond a little bit better to slightly higher volume compared to other body parts, and that's based purely on my professional observation, so I can't cite you a study on that one. So do with that what you will. Argue with me about it in the comments section and tell me there's no evidence to support that outside of PubMed, and then I'll tell you the other more important evidence of having actually trained people shows me that maybe a little bit higher volume for delts is a good thing. So again, do with that what you will. And then do the YouTube thing. So like, subscribe, share with your mom, her delts suck. And if you guys want awesome workouts like this, I keep forgetting, I said beforehand, I gotta plug my app. They said I should too. They didn't say it's a bad thing too. But if you want better workouts, better programs like this, look down in the description down below. Let me put like 12,000 things in there. So you can try out my app, you can try it for free, you can buy a shirt, you can buy some cuffs. I got cuffs. That's a good pro. See those cuffs? I sell those too. They're in the description. I honestly didn't think about it ahead of time. Go buy some shit. I got kids to feed, I got a minivan to drive. That's not a joke, they've seen the minivan. There's a Tahoe out there now, but I have a minivan too. And as always, hope you guys enjoyed it, took something away. Get down in that comment section and get rowdy. Till the next one.